Come, come, gather round, everyone. They're about to talk Disney. I am still so confused as to whether I'm going to eat at Connections or Creations. So the only way I can keep them straight is I have to think, okay, well, my mouth connects to my stomach, so I guess that's Connections.
So I call Catherine to see how dinner at the restaurant is going, and she says, I can't talk to you right now. I'm talking to Mickey. So I'm like, okay, here's the big cheese. I get it. And then she says, hold on, he wants to talk to you. So she FaceTimes me, and I'm FaceTiming with Mickey as I'm getting ready for the podcast.
I don't understand why people spend hard-earned money on a Mickey ice cream sandwich in the parks. I mean, we literally all have ice cream sandwiches in our freezers at home. We don't have Mickey bars. From the mind and creator of the Disney YouTube channel Living in Diz, comes a whole new Disney podcast. Okay, can we talk some serious Disney here now? Nope. Get ready for all the Disney knowledge that you can handle. It's Corey. It's Lawrence. It's the DIZPod.
You are now listening to a member of the Disney Podcast family. Head over to Disney Podcast Family on Instagram to see all the latest posts for this show and links to other great Disney podcasts.
Hello and welcome to the DIZPod, everyone. It must be Wednesday night once again. And here we are, Lawrence, and I put you on the spot and say, what is this? Is this episode number 45?
43, I actually checked last night. 43.
Okay.
Yeah.
43. Where is the time gone?
Crazy. We're coming up on our 50th show. I actually started thinking about what we were going to do for the 50th. So starting to get that in line for sure.
It's crazy. It's crazy. So, yeah, 50, man. It goes fast. On our trip to 500. And then we're going to drop the mic right
That's
here on
right.
the desk. 500 episodes, and then we're done. We're walking away.
I might not drop this one. It's kind of expensive, so I'll just lay it down quietly, but yes.
Yeah. They're heavy. When you take it off the arm, they're pretty heavy. They are heavy. But, yeah, good job. So it is currently 65 degrees here in Central Florida. Rainy today. Torrential rains with threats of tornadoes, but... I'm not super experienced at that, but looking out the window, they may have lifted that by now. Just a little bit of drizzle. So a dreary day here in Florida, if you're listening live to the DIZPod. But I don't know. Did you have the same kind of weather today?
No, it is 71 and very bright. In fact, I had to put a cover over my window because I was getting a weird glare in the first show, in the members only show. So no, bright and sunny. We went to the Durham Bulls game yesterday. Yeah, so it was their home opener. They lost 5-3, but they had the bases loaded in the bottom of the ninth with one out.
Heartbreaker.
Oh, so tough, so tough. But because it was opening night, they had fireworks afterwards, so I got to see a little bit of fireworks. And it was at 9 o'clock, so it kind of felt like luminous, but it was not. But they still did a great job. They had some great fireworks.
Listen, when you go to Disney as much as we do and you see these fireworks all the time, we become fireworks snobs.
That's right. That's
you know,
right.
I've been back to my home city and visiting, and it happens to be a 4th of July, and people are like, you going out to fireworks? I don't know. I don't think I want to deal with the crowd and deal with, you know, 5-minute fireworks
that
aren't nearly as dazzling and magical. Yeah. Not to say that they're not bad, but, you know, I'd rather not fight a crowd and just go see Disney fireworks the next day.
Exactly.
Yeah. So what do we got on tap tonight? I don't have much else to bring to the table besides the weather today. Nothing nothing crazy has happened since I've last talked to you. So I guess that means things have been pretty smooth.
Yeah, it's been a pretty smooth week. It was nice to kind of decide on what our topic for tonight's show was going to be about the day after last show, so that we had a little time to prepare. And I actually reached out to some folks that run a Facebook group that I'm in about it, so that they could talk to us about it. And sure enough, they wanted to come on and even sent us more guests. So we've got a jam-packed show tonight. Thanks to them for sure.
That's awesome. This is actually a record breaker for us. Like two sets of guests in That's one right. show. It's kind of crazy. Show.
Yeah.
I told
yeah.
Tammy, I'm like, the podcast is going to be like an hour tonight because we have everything scheduled. Well, we're allowed to just kind of go on our own. It can go to like 2 hours.
Yeah. Yeah.
So this is good. This is good too. So yeah, I guess lastly, before we bring him in, you and I beat our heads against the wall we're ahead of technology right now. We're like George Lucas, like our vision. We need technology to catch up so we can bring the next thing to the Disney parks and streaming. The idea
is coming.
There.
It's coming.
It's coming. We'll be the first to bring it to you.
I reached out to somebody to ask them about doing what we need them to do. Haven't heard back, but
okay.
I just want to know, is it in the works?
I met a guy today too that said, you know, he has plenty of things he can fabricate. So
okay.
Let him know. All right. All right. I think I'm going to bring the equipment to him on Friday.
All right.
And let him take an assessment that way too. And see.
Yeah. There's a lot you can fabricate now. So
absolutely.
We'll see.
So without further ado, I'm going to give the floor to you. I'll follow up with you.
So as I had mentioned, I am in a Disney Facebook group, a Disney VIP share group for tours. And so I reached out to the moderators. I really just reached out. I was like, can any moderator call me or message me? And Jason was nice enough to respond the next morning and was so gracious to not only come on, but also to get us in touch with Ken, the author of Before the Bird Sang. And so he'll be coming on our second segment. But Jason was nice enough to come on and bring in Sharon, who can talk about the organization Founding Love. So you want to bring them in?
Yes. You want me to get it?
Yeah.
All right.
There we are.
Hi.
Hi. Hey. Welcome.
Hello, everyone. How are we? I feel like you've got the shirts in the backgrounds. I'm glad that I've stepped up my game on my side, too. So thank you.
Sorry, I just couldn't do more today.
That's quite all right. We appreciate you being here. I was actually going to message you all and say, hey, we wear Disney button-down shirts, but that is, you know, if I had said Disney t-shirts, probably we all have Disney t-shirts. Disney button-down shirts, not as much. So I didn't want to put you on the spot.
There you go.
I mean, I actually have that shirt, Lawrence. So I was like, oh, I should have worn that. We could have like matched, and then Corey would have been like, wait, did we miss a memo?
Exactly.
Yeah, Disney's... I love Disney. You'll hear that from me throughout the podcast. And I think you're going to find that by the end of this, you will, when we think about Disney, we think about the stories, we think about the immersiveness and the connections to those stories that Disney makes in small ways, right? The easiest one that we can think about is like Hidden Mickeys. Mm-hmm. You will find that by the end of this podcast, the new fun ways that Disney has connected many people, including in my orbit, most importantly in Sharon's world, because it is through Disney that we actually got to meet. It's totally fun. So quick backstory on me. Mm-hmm. I grew up going to Disney as a kid. I was very lucky. My family always used to take us to Disney, and they always used to just give me the best in life, right? Like, you go there, you ride the rides, and COVID happened, and it became very clear to me that I wanted to do something to give back to my family. So I called up my aunt and I was like, hey, this thing is lifting. We should go to Disney. And I took her to Disney. And we did the exact sort of same things that we would have done when I was a kid, but now I got to pay it back to her. Whilst I was there, I met this incredible couple behind this nonprofit that you mentioned off the top, Funding Love. And they basically, in the easiest form, think of it as they're adoptive parents, and they support the post-adoption triad. So, you know, when you think about adoption, it's a range of emotions. It's happy, it's amazing, it's beautiful, it's muddy, it's costly, it is trauma. It's both sides of this sort of emotional pendulum. Mm-hmm. And they realized that for them, as I was standing in a line and I was just talking to them, I was like, oh, tell me about this. And they told me about it. And they said, we believe that Disney is a way to strengthen bonds, make a difference, you know, create a space where once you've adopted and you've spent, in some cases, hundreds of thousands of dollars, you don't have the money to do a trip to Disney. You don't have the ability to do a Disney VIP tour. You're just trying to basically clear the bills. And so what they do is they do two trips a year, one for birth mothers and one for newly adopted families. And they take families on all expense paid trips to Disney World. Everything. Airfare, hotel. They send everybody into the parks onto a VIP tour, which Sharon and I are going to talk about here in a few minutes with you guys. They even give them a little small stipend of spending money to create, to find something in the parks that they would like to buy to create a memory. And for a whole week, they basically get to forget about all of these problems, these worries, and these concerns from this experience, this journey that is both beautiful and traumatic, and just focus on being a family and creating that bond as a family. I'm a sucker for these types of things because I love this story. And I was like, how do I help? I want in on this. And I started volunteering with them. And then I was like, wait, talk to me about these VIP tours. And it is from that I actually bumped into the Facebook group that actually was started by Sharon. And I was like, wait a second, tell me about VIP tours. And so I learned all about them. She schooled me up on them. I then did several of them. We've actually had been adminning and moderating this Facebook group together, having never met in person. And then we met at the Disney parks for the first time.
Nice.
And it's just one of those things where you're just like, oh my gosh, what a, not cliche, Corey, get ready. It's a small world. I had to, I know. You start to realize how small this world is. And so the plug on Funding Love, just real briefly, is they have a gala coming up. So they're nonprofit, 501c. And so every year they do a sort of a marquee or a tentpole event. It's April 26th. It is at the beautiful Four Seasons down in Orlando. They have a whole night planned. So full dinner, cocktail hour, entertainment, music. Okay, guys, here's the best part. They get Mickey and Minnie.
What?
At this event. Right? I'm like, how do you go about getting Mickey and Minnie? I'm so confused.
Wow.
They get, and by the way, let me just be clear. I'm not talking about some knockoff. I'm talking about, like, they get the official nice. Mickey and Minnie that show up. They take photos and everything. And then there's a silent auction, live auction that they do. all of the money raised goes towards helping the adoption community and the trips for with which then they take these families on. We've got original artwork. I got something signed from John Stamos, who's a big Disney fan. I just the other day, and I had to ship it off to the folks down there, but I had a Patrick Mahomes signed football.
Wow.
So that, wow. Yeah, there's some big items. There might be some fan made replica Muppet items in the gala. So again, all just sort of designed to create this beautiful opportunity for families, which I told you, I was like, I can book your whole podcast for you. but here's the fun part. I then realized that Sharon has a story that is closely connected to the adoption community as well. And you just start talking to people and you start to learn all these really cool things about our history, our backgrounds, and the stories behind it. And so I won't steal the show, but I'll let her talk a little bit about that, how we kind of came together, about the group. But happy to answer any questions on the funding love stuff. And then, you know, part of that experience is then they also take people on VIP tours, which is a perfect segue to Sharon anyways. Because I think the big thing with VIP tours is you think VIP and you think, oh gosh, it's expensive. That's exactly why she created this Facebook group, guys. Because, you know, who doesn't want to feel like a VIP?
Right.
Right? I mean, I do.
You are a VIP, Jason.
Corey definitely wants to. Right? I mean, he's got an on-air button behind him, guys. Like, come on now.
Yeah, it's right there.
Right? Yeah, like, yeah, there you go. I mean, and I've got, like, this older chair behind me. So,
love it.
Which Allison recognized your background right away. She was like, oh my God.
Where's Doug? I mean, I think VIP, right? Hold on. I'm on a line. Yeah, he's right next to me. I can see his nose. I think when we think about VIP, we think it's got to be expensive. And the great part is they are, but they don't have to be for everyone. So Sharon created this beautiful space, this beautiful group, and she has poured her heart and soul into it. I am but a small piece of this puzzle. So it is an honor to have her with us tonight to kind of talk about it. So Sharon, I will let the team of Lawrence and Corey and everybody hear about how you all came into it and your beautiful space story of adoption as well.
Okie doke. So, hey guys. So I remember we happened to be going to Disney in August of 2019. So what happened then? Do you remember? Galaxy's Edge opening day, right? Mm-hmm. And we were actually supposed to leave like the 27th. And I was like, oh my goodness, we can't miss this opportunity to be there for opening day. So we like rearranged everything and we extended our trip an extra 3 days so that we could be there. And I was like, oh my goodness, we were there for opening day at Toy Story Land. And we waited, I think, something like 6 hours for Slinky Dog Dash. And that was a madhouse. And I said, oh my goodness, you know, Star Wars fans are like next level. This is not going to be like that. I was like, there's no way. And I had my kids with me and they were like 7 and 11 at that point. And I was like, I can't sleep in the parking lot. Like, I was like, there has to be a way so that we can get in and they can see it. Even if we don't get to ride anything, just to be like, we were there for opening day. Right. So I was looking around and I'm a travel agent too, right? So I've been through all the trainings and I said to myself, you know what? Maybe we could do a VIP tour, but like they're super expensive. And I researched it and it was $450 an hour. And I said, wow, you know, that's a big chunk of change. And I don't know that I can like bring myself to spend that much money And I was kind of annoyed because I'm kind of a bargain shopper too. Like, I do like the deluxe resorts and I like all the great stuff, but I also am like, I want to get the best bang for my buck. So I said, you know, it's just the three of us. It's just my kids and myself. So the tours fit up to 10 people. And I said, well, what if I could find people that wanted to come with us and we could share the VIP tour? I said,
me, yes. Chloe and Lawrence want to come too.
Yes.
For sure. So I reached out onto two Facebook groups, existing Facebook groups, and one of them, like, they like ripped me a new one. They were like, if you can't afford a VIP tour, like, don't even bother. You shouldn't be going on one. I can't believe you want people to pay for your tour. And I was like, that's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying, like, I want to pay for my portion of the tour. Mm-hmm. But like, why can't I bring other people with me to, like, you know, make it a little bit more cost friendly, right? So then I went to another Facebook group, which was the DVC group. And like, you know, DVC members, we understand, like, we know Disney, we understand that, like, our money goes further when we do this, right? Like, we have the DVC, so we get to stay at the nicer resorts. And so those people were like, this is a brilliant idea. And so by the end of the night, I had, you know, seven other people that were like, yeah, let's sign me up. I want to do it. And so I was like, okay. And I was super nervous because I was like, what if people flake? What if people don't show? Because then I'm on the hook for all this money, right? And so I set up a Facebook chat. We chatted about it. Everybody, you know, gave me a gift card so we could pay for it up ahead of time, right? And so we met and we got picked up at 5:45 at our hotel because we had to be there for what, 7 a.m.? And so we all met and it was like the best day ever. You know how like Rapunzel says best day ever? It was the best day ever because we got to get in and we just like walked past all the people and it was ridiculous. Like, I mean, you couldn't even get in. Like the parking lot was gridlocked, but they take you backstage. So you come in by where Rock and Roller Coaster is. Like you walk back Tower of Terror and come in. And we got to do everything and we got to see everything and we got to be there. And, you know, and our VIP tour guide, his name was John, and he was so amazing. He happened to be like the opening day, like manager or something for Pandora. And he also worked at Hollywood Studios. So he knew all these amazing things about the parks that I didn't know. And I had been to Disney at that point, I don't know, maybe 25 times. Mm. He was like, did you know that this says this? And did you know that there's a little Millennium Falcon on the Millennium Falcon? I was like, what? He's like, yeah, right there. And I was like, what? And he was like, oh, and this sign says that these are not the droids you're looking for. And I was like, I love all these little details. And so he made the day so special. And my daughter was there and she was dressed like Rey. And we love Star Wars, right? So they're really not supposed to do the character interactions, but he like got Rey to come like to the side and like she got to like talk to Rey and she was so excited and she's like teaching her how to use the Force.
Oh wow.
And it was just such a great day. And those people are still in the Facebook group and they're like the founding members, right? So, you know, we actually just talked about it because it was coming up on 6 years, I think. So it's just been like a wild ride. But people, I have a friend who was on the tour and he said to me, oh, Sharon, you know, my buddy went on a tour and he's like, and I mentioned that, you know, I'm friends with so-and-so. And he was like, you were on the founding tour. So like, I was like, you're famous in your own right. Right. So, you know, I just thought to myself, well, I think this is a great idea, right? Because like a lot of people would like to do a VIP tour, but most people I talk to are they're like, oh, that's out of my budget. And I was like, it really doesn't have to be, because if it's $450 an hour to $900 an hour, you know, and you share it with, you know, 10 people, your cost goes down significantly, right? So it's kind of like a bucket list thing for a lot of people. And like, especially people that are like one or two, I mean, it's totally doable, right? Like you spend that much on like, I don't know, anything, anything at Disney, in the gift shop, right? Yeah. On those fabulous shirts you're wearing. Yeah. So that's where we came up with the idea. And we started with like 10 people. And now we're like almost to 24,000.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah, and fun fact about that, I was looking just ahead of this podcast for, you know, I was like, okay, but because people think about on social, like, oh, you have 24,000. How many of those are active people, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. As of today, in the last 30 days, roughly 19,000 are active. So if you think about that, that's about what, 80%-ish, 90% of the group is in some way, shape, or form. And why I say that is because I think to Sharon's point, what you start to realize is that once you do the VIP tour, the group stays relevant to you because now you then pass that knowledge along. You pass along not all of the magic, but you pass along the best practices, right? So for those listeners that are out there that are like, wait, I hear this VIP thing. What? How do I know this? Where is this? These are usually going to be as you walk around the parks. You probably noticed them, but you didn't associate them as VIP guides. But essentially, this is a cast member. You'll notice them. They're usually in plaid, like a red and black plaid outfit. And they are usually walking around with people. Those would be people that are on their tour. So think of it as like your own personal cast member guide for the day, right? And so just a couple of mechanics, like to Sharon's point, the price range is on an hourly basis, up to 10 people can go into the tour, and it doesn't cost you any more or less if there's one person in that group or 10 people in that group, right? So that helps defray the cost. But you do have to book 8 consecutive hours,
7.
Right? So now all of a sudden, if you start thinking about it, just making it easy, $500 an hour times 8, you do the math, but then you get to divide that out by the number of people in the group, and that sort of gets you there. But once you've got that set, the guide is yours. You choose when you start your day. You can go up to 10 hours, and they'll just tack on the additional hours into your fee. But think about it. You choose when you start your day. Sharon was lucky. She did the really bougie thing and had them pick her up. They will pick you up at your hotel in a car, wow, right from your hotel, drive you to the airport. Now, here's the – or drive you to the park. Here's the cool part, right? Corey, you mentioned about the fireworks, and you're like, oh, I just don't want to deal with, you know, the aftermath of then having to get out of the parks. Great. If you're on a VIP tour, not only do you get to go into that VIP area at Disneyland Disney World at Magic Kingdom, right in that kind of grassy area up front, but the second the fireworks are over, if you want, you can have your guide basically whisk you out back into a black executive car van,
like
and take you right back to your hotel, and you're past all of the crowds.
Yes.
Right?
Wow.
I think that if you're doing like a tour on like Christmas or New Year's Eve, that's a totally valid like use of your time, because those, I mean, we've all waited for the monorail after that or the ferry ride. I mean, it's a hot mess. And so, I mean, for me, I would totally do it on the 4th of July or the 3rd of July, because they do it twice, right?
Yeah. So think about it. Once you do that, you pick your start date, your start time and your park. You say, hey, I want my tour to start at 10 a.m. and I want to start at Hollywood Studios or Magic Kingdom. Like, you pick.
Yeah.
As long as you have a park pass and park hopper, you can go to any park, any ride, anytime. And there's no, you don't get that. I think people oftentimes kind of get this impression, like when you go, you got to plan everything. And Sharon and I, and I'm sure some of your listeners, so I'm not saying this is a bad thing, but some people have an Excel spreadsheet that is like minute by minute, like we're going to the park at 9 o'clock. We're going to be on this ride and then we're going to go to this ride.
I used to. I was on the vacation.
I don't think first 10 years, right?
I have a whole formula.
I always say it's Danny Tanner and his clipboard of fun, right?
There you go.
So there's always somebody that will do that, right? Because they're trying to maximize their time.
Yes.
One of the things that's great is that with VIP tours, you just basically tell the guide, like, hey, that morning, you're like, where do you want to start? I don't know. Let's start with Rise of the Resistance. Great. And then you walk there. And you're like, well, where do we go next? Where do you want to go next? Well, I'd like to go to Toy Story. Great, we'll walk over to Toy Story. Each of these rides, you'll generally, now there are a few exceptions, but generally you're going to go through that sort of legacy fast pass, now lightning lane experience. So it is sort of an expedited journey. It is not no wait. And I think that's a really important thing to kind of call out, is that sometimes people are like, VIP, we cut the line. No, yeah. You do get faster through the lines because you don't have to worry about getting the individual lightning lanes throughout the day. You'll just go right into them with your guide. But you still have a small wait. Now, certain rides will have even shorter passes. So like, for one, and I'm not going to give away all the magic here, but like, my favorite is Haunted Mansion. There's actually a backdoor entrance into the Haunted Mansion that can take you directly into the stretching room and then slip you right onto the ride, right? So that's obviously wonderful.
Corey has seen that.
You've been inside the little corridor? Okay.
I have.
Okay.
At Flight of Passage, there's a special door, and if the line for the lightning lane is like further than a certain point, they'll even walk you through that. But it's really great, and I have to say that, like, all right, so I'm a travel planner, right? I plan people's Disney vacations all day long, and people are like, oh, what do I do first? What do I do this? And so I'm like, you know what? I'm on vacation. Like, I just want to be mom, and like, I want to like take pictures of my kids, even though it annoys them. And I want to be present. Like, I want to be able to like see things and like see the looks on their faces when they experience things, and not have my phone like this looking for the next, you know, fast pass, or I'm sorry, the next lightning lane or whatever it is. So like, the VIP tour is super liberating for moms and dads that are, you know, the type A, right? But it's so nice because I don't have to plan anything. I can say, okay, these are the rides I want to do. Like, this is how long we're thinking. You tell me what you think. And the great thing is that they have their little PDAs, right? Their iPhones that have like real-time information. So they can say, all right, you know what? Rise of the Resistance went down, so let's go do this instead. And then they're like, oh, it's back up. Let's go. Mm. So, you know, it really streamlines your time. And like, you don't realize like how long it takes to get from one park to another park when you're on your own. But when you're on the tour, it's like, you're 20 minutes and you're like, I'm physically in the next park, ready to go on the next ride. So it's great.
Yeah. And so that's the other thing. Like, when you think about park hopping, you're like, monorail, bus, right? No. You actually, not on a VIP tour, you actually will, they'll escort you backstage or offstage into vans and cars waiting behind the parks. And then your guide will actually drive you to the next park. Then you will come back on stage. The other nuances that I think are always fun, unlimited soda and water all day long. You just ask and they'll get it. Right? You don't even, yeah, that's the, I mean, it's like wonderful. And if you don't, you know, because you get caught up in the festivities and the fun, sometimes they'll surprise you. And they'll, you know, you'll walk off of a ride and your guide will be there with a tray of drinks ready for you. Sometimes when you go out back to move parks, there's some surprises, is I guess what I'll call it, out back for you to, you know, to munch on. And usually there's almost always, I heard in the opening, so I have to call this out, you know, there was the whole Mickey bar thing. There might be a Mickey bar included in there.
Or strawberry
bar. As long as there aren't any Mickey ice cream sandwiches.
Right?
I actually get the Mickey chip. I get that one.
You get the Mickey. Oh, no.
But, you know, I think it's definitely an experience. Now, here's a good question for everyone. So, Corey, what's your favorite ride?
I love these questions because there's so many different parks. So if
it's only one.
Favorite ride is probably going to just have to be Haunted Mansion.
Okay.
Okay. Wow, Lawrence? Not expecting that. Favorite ride, Guardians.
It's so good.
Ooh, both of those are. So my wife loves Haunted Mansion. I love Guardians. Sharon, where are you at in this narrative?
I would have said before Guardians came out, I would have said Flight of Passage, but now Guardians is definitely like tip the scale, it's up there, because it's just so much fun. Like, and you never know what song you're gonna get, and like during the holidays they had like different songs too, so I love it. Although Tron is so much fun too, I love Tron, but I wish it was like 30 seconds longer, because you're like, oh, this is really great, this is really good. Oh,
it's yeah. Yeah,
I do agree. I think if Tron came out first.
What's your gripe?
I have a gripe, and I look at it now, and I talk to it out loud while I'm live sometimes because we have issues. It's the fact that, and I'm sure there's reasons for it, but the queue for Tron is not the same as for Guardians. So I like to say that it has no respect for the working person in Florida, because I can wake up and get a 7 a.m., time for Guardians and stroll in there at 7 p.m. at night after work and get on Guardians. Tron, you can try, but the chances of you getting a time that's going to coincide with you getting there later, you have to be there within the hour. I think it's the hour.
Yeah.
So there's no leeway on that. So I have only ridden Tron like what, twice in my life?
I think I have no inside knowledge. So let me just caveat this. But I think that the difference is that early on there were a number of people that were grabbing the 7 a.m. and then holding it until nighttime, because obviously the nighttime ride is very different than during the day. Because everything's illuminated, you know, when you go through the canopy, the blue lights kind of follow you. So the experience is different. And so in order to do that, and in order to control how long those lines are, I mean, if you think about it, everybody would grab the 7 a.m. and grab the 1 p.m. and everybody would then collectively show up at 6:30 at night.
Exactly.
And it wouldn't probably work. Whereas Guardians, the ride experience inside is the same across all times.
Yeah.
So that's kind of fun.
That's a great explanation. That makes total sense.
Yeah.
Hold on. Now we got like, we're fancy over here. We got quite, the tour is an hourly price in addition to the cost of a park hopper ticket.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. So you will still need your park hopper ticket. The tour cost will be on top of it.
If you don't want to do more than one park in during your VIP tour, you don't actually have to have the hopper ticket, but you know, it does make that 4-park challenge like a cakewalk. So yeah.
Mm.
4-park challenge. We've done that.
So the reason I asked about everybody's favorite rides is because, so Corey, for you, what happens if you ride Haunted Mansion, but the main line is long, the Lightning Lane is short, and you get off of it and you're like, that was so much fun, I want to ride it again. Because maybe you saw that cool Raleigh Crump wax figure off the left side of the Doom Buggy and you're like, I want to see that again. Or you want to figure out what's actually in those hat boxes.
Yeah, yeah.
So with VIP tours, you can re-ride the same ride as many times as you want. So you could say to your guide, look, hey, I just got off of it. I want to get right back on it. Now, this is much more preferential to a couple of rides. Like, so there's some only nuances out there. Tron is still once a day.
Galaxy Guardians is twice.
Guardians is twice.
And Rise of the Resistance
is once.
Yeah.
But outside of that, you can ride them all. I mean, right. So what I suggest, pro tip, is start your tour. If you love Guardians, so Lawrence, this is right for you and me. Grab the virtual queue.
Oh, I love Guardians too, by the way.
You're on Haunted Mansion, Corey. You had your chance. You chose Madame Leota.
I did.
But okay, fine. You can come on. It's fine. We'll bring you along. We'll sneak you in. But
yeah, I mean, we're at Epcot right now.
Right, exactly. But what you could do is you could actually grab the 7 a.m. Lightning Lane, go on Guardians, and then go start your tour, ride it twice on the tour. So now you're riding it three times in the day. I will tell you, after three times, like I love the ride, but after three times, even I'm good.
We did it four times on the afternoon, and I thought I was gonna hurl. I was like, it was still early, and I'm like, we could do it. Oh no, I can't do it again.
I rode it in previews, and I rode it on opening day. So, and I did the same with Tron. The only difference is I could not get the DVC preview. I could only get the AP preview. DVC is like Fight Club. You got to like work at it to get it because I think their ticket volume is like really small. But the experience is absolutely magical. I agree. Here's a fun fact. Let's test everybody's knowledge. There is a Donald Duck inside of Hollywood Studios that is hidden. Does anybody know where it is?
Oh, wow. A hidden Donald. No.
No.
But my mind is racing through Hollywood Studios right now.
Yeah.
Think about it for a second. Let me see what this... So Disney Junior asks, is the extra VIP magic hours with Mickey Mouse? Sharon, you want to take that one? I think it's asking the question of... This isn't the... Yeah.
It's not the after hours events. It's not... It's totally separate from that. It's through Disney Signature Services, and you can meet Mickey during them. Like as long as whatever it is that you want has a lightning lane, you can do it on your tour. So if you want to, you know, spend your time meeting characters, like people do that. You know, I've had people, very like elderly people, go on tours, and sometimes they just really like to like see all the stuff and get kind of that background information. And hear things, you know, people that have like really young kids, they do a lot of the characters and stuff. So whatever you're into, you can do on your, like, it's literally your tour. So the tour is, it can, the minimum is actually 7 hours, and it's $450 an hour through 900 an hour. So like, Christmas Eve, 900 an hour, you know, New Year's Eve, 900 an hour. The end of August, when I go every year, that's $450 usually, unless they up the price. But
it's a daily number, so yeah. Every day is a different, potentially a different price. So typically during the week is going to be usually the cheaper weekends. So Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sundays are going to be the higher price. Then there's obviously your peak and off peak. So it does vary a little bit, which is why having your travel agent kind of work with you to book it is really kind of helpful. Like people are like, why do you use a travel agent? I'm like, because it makes my life easier.
Right.
And then, you know, and then I just call up Sharon, and I do, by the way, I use Sharon. I'm like, Sharon, I want to do a VIP tour. Will you please help me? And then she takes care of booking it. And then we use, of course, like I've met some incredible people from the Facebook group, and it's weird, 'cause like as a moderator and as an admin in the group, people are like, oh my God. I'm like, no,
it's so fancy.
I promise. Let's just go on a tour. And in fact, there was another group, in there that's sort of solo travelers, and my wife and I actually had a couple of solo travelers join us. We had such a wonderful time, and hold on, Jason, would Donald Duck be hiding to the left hand side as you walk in the park? That is not the one I'm thinking about, but I think Courtney might have given you guys a clue along the way. I will answer that in just 1 second and tell you exactly where it is. And I'll also give you another little fun fact that I found out about. So we went back down there about a month and a half ago, and I just randomly had messaged the solo traveler and was like, hey, we're going down. She drove up, and we spent the whole day together. Like, we've just become friends. And we did a different VIP tour with about 7 or 8 of us back about 6 months ago. And in fact, tomorrow I'm flying down, and a number of the people from that group are going to be there, and we're all getting together for, you know, drinks or dinner or whatnot. So again, these tours are so much more than just the VIP experience. They're connecting you with people that I believe have the opportunity to become friends, additional park goers, anytime I can convince them. Really quick, funny story. This is hilarious, because I told this one to Sharon and she was like, I can't believe you did this. But on my last tour, we were in Oga's and we were just hanging out at the end. Our tour had ended. I had said, ooh, the Disney Treasure has just announced. We should do a cruise. And I just already messaged my travel agent and booked the Disney Treasure. And so the people on the tour with me were like, wait, what? Went ahead, booked it. So we're doing the Disney Treasure at the end of the year as a group as well. So here again, you start to see these relationships form in bigger ways that can start to really transform the way you go to the parks. So I promised you I would tell you where the Donald is. So actually, Donald is in Galaxy's Edge. If you are, Courtney, I think, had mentioned about Ogas. If you look at Ogas and you look at a deadhead on, the actual banner ahead of Ogas is actually Donald Duck's head and hat and everything. So that's a nice little, not hidden Mickey, but like a hidden Donald in there, which is always fun.
Nice.
And wow. Then I'll give you two other fun facts that are my personal favorites. And now everybody's going to go look for them and watch them. but again, so when you look around Galaxy's Edge, you'll see a lot of, if you look at some of the walkways, and you'll see like these big, huge cylinders just kind of like thrown about inside of Galaxy's Edge as part of the decor. Would you believe that it's actually old airplane engines? True story.
Oh, really?
True. Yeah. Wow. Next time you go, look around. They're all either airplane engine parts. They're some of the blades inside are there. But they've retrofitted that whole area with sort of retired airplane parts to create sort of the experience, which, you know, for a Disney fan like me, and I'm a huge fan of not just Disney, but like Walt and him as a, like I've done the Burbank studio tour. I was moved to almost tears. I mean, it's just very difficult for me to stand there and be like, this is where the magic actually was created. Like when you stand in his office and you see the piano that the Sherman brothers actually played on, that's just like tough to kind of comprehend. I love learning these little tidbits behind the scenes. My last little tidbit that I absolutely is my favorite is it's not a hidden Mickey, but I heard in the opening talking about Mickey's Runaway Train. When you're watching the pre-show, you should pay very close attention to Mickey and Minnie. I'm not going to tell you why, because I want you to go look at it. But I think there's something about Minnie when Mickey and Minnie are in their car driving along that you might find interesting. So look closely, and then when we come up on, so this is episode 43 for everybody listening. When we come up on episode 50, Laura and Corey are going to have me back, and I'll just tell them where it is. I'll tell them exactly what it is. That's how we'll do it. And then there'll be fireworks. And then we'll whisk Corey off into a car to drive him off.
I'm going to be fireworks.
Sounds good. Hey.
Oh, nope, that's balloon. Oh, well.
Oh, you did do it. You pulled AI out on me. I love it. But yeah, guys, look, I mean, I think the history of the parks is really fun. And I think learning about beyond just the hidden Mickeys, the history, the stories, and the immersiveness of it are fun. And it's also interesting to me because one of the more legacy attractions that was actually not at Disney World, but at Disneyland. I love this fun information, Jason. Oh, Nanny Pooh Bear, we love you. that's so kind of you. Thank you, truly. Like I love talking to people in lines. Fireworks, two thumbs up. Oh, you guys, stop that. You're gonna make me blush. I truly do. Ah! Yes, hey. Hey, fireworks, Corey. These
that's
are
good.
No. I love sharing the knowledge, like, because people have been very fortunate and shared it with me. Sharon shared a lot of it with me around VIP tours when I started out. You know, so when I'm in the parks, I love talking about them. but it's interesting because like one of the earlier rides at Disneyland that actually Walt funded himself was the Tiki Room, which is like a beautiful segue for us because it's all the things. It's an original. It's the animatronics and all this stuff. And so I a couple of weeks ago, I had stumbled across a couple of former Disney Imagineers that I follow on social. I started seeing reviews of this new book that was out by Ken Bruce. And I was like, wait, what is this before the birds sing words? And I wanted it for the Funding Love Gala. And so I reached out. I was like, Ken? And so Ken sent me said book. And so as part of it, I have not fully read through all of it yet. It is on my list of things. I'm going to be reading it tomorrow when I head down to Florida. But I thought, wow, when you guys approached us about this, I was like, what a perfect opportunity as we're talking about VIP tours and the different rides to sort of pull in a little bit of the history. So for like Nanny the Pooh Bear, who made the comment, and a few of those other folk, Courtney on Main Street, you might love Becky with the mini ears. I love these names.
I get the same when I'm live in the parks all the time.
Yeah.
Can I just say, like, whoever is doing these things at the bottom, like, they're pulling in these things. Like, I love this. Like, I've done other podcasts, and y'all are, like, stepping up the tech game here. So I love it.
Hey, we're not the number eight podcast in the Disney World community for nothing.
Right?
In the world.
That's right.
This is fun. But yeah. So I wanted to bring Sharon in to talk to you about VIP tours. And by the way, if you ranked top 10 best Disney podcasts, look at this. So the group that we're all talking about on Facebook is the Original Disney VIP Tour Share. You'll see it. It's got about 24,000 people in it. You're free to join. There's a couple of questions just to make sure you're not a spam bot. Everything in there is nicely organized. We've poured a ton. We're all volunteers, by the way. We get nothing for this either. But we poured in information about, like, what are the tours? How do they work? Questions you should ask. Can you leave, a young infant in a stroller with the guide while you go on a ride?
I can attest to that. They will push the stroller for
they
you.
They will, yeah.
They will. They'll push the stroller for
They'll
you.
Even change the baby. No, I'm just kidding.
Maybe some of them. And we have a lot of information about, like, because people, like, you know, that's not something that people do every day. So, you know, people were like, wait, you have to tip the guide? And we're like, yes.
Yeah. So, and we're trying to give you ideas on what that should be and how to approach that.
What's customary? Okay, yeah.
It is customary.
It's a can of worms. But, you know,
Most of the staff at Disney are not allowed to have, like, you can't give
no
them
tips.
Anything.
That's right.
Right. You might be able to give them a small trinket or a token of some sort to say thank
what
you.
Jason always does. He makes pins for the cast members, and he makes, like, people just, like, cry.
I do. So I have little pins that I make every year that I design, and I only give them out to cast members. And you'd be surprised at how, like, emotional they become over a small thing, like either a pin. I have cards that I will give, or lanyards or things. And it's emotional for them, right? Like, I know everybody spends a lot of money to go to Disney. I get it. I do too. I truly do. But I have to tell you, like, the one time you'll see me change from happy Jason to serious Jason is I am passionate and unapologetic about the fact that you have to do good in this world. You have to be kind. And I have unfortunately watched as some of the cast members have been treated very, very badly. And maybe the easiest way to do it is say, if I give you a pin, and that pin, $3 pin, creates a visceral sort of reaction of tears and just breaking down. Think about how tough of a day or of a week or of a shift they must be having to create that moment.
We actually,
from a pin.
We had a tour guide who he was really beloved, and he actually lost his wife, and she was a guide too. And I said to myself, I cannot imagine being this man and, you know, having to go to work every day and make everyone's best day ever, right? You know, while my family was, like, falling apart. And these people, these cast members, they come every day and they make magic for us, for our families. They make it special for us, even though they might be going through something unimaginable. And so I guess, you know, what Jason and I have to say all the time is, like, just be nice, like, treat people how you would expect to be treated, and be kind. And, you know, yeah, we're hot, we're tired, you know, there's long lines, but, you know, at the end of the day, you're in the happiest place on earth, and you're doing what you love. So just be nice. Take a nap. Yeah. Get a Mickey bar.
Right? It's the frozen chocolate. Actually, I'll tell you, I just tried the spring rolls for the first time.
The cheeseburger
what
one?
What have I been missing? Why have I not done these spring rolls before? My wife and I were like, oh, the line is always on. We're like, ah, they're spring rolls. And I was like, you know what? We've never tried them. We should try them. And then I was like, hooked. I was like, now I understand. This is a problem for me.
Which one did you get?
Both of them. We just tried both. Like, but the cheeseburger is like ridiculously, insanely amazing. I don't know. Like the chicken tenders are good. The pizza's good. Like it's a problem. The whole thing. I just can't go to Disney and not like eat my way around all of it. How does one go about booking a VIP tour? I'll answer this for 86. So you can either do a couple of things. One, you can book it on your own. You can reach out to VIP tour services. They'll go through everything with you and you can totally do that. Second option is you can join somebody else's tour. So something like within our Facebook group, you might find somebody that's traveling that has already booked it, and then you just coordinate that with them. The only caveat that I tell you is you should only send money directly to Disney. So uh-huh. Once you decide to do a tour share, you would call Disney Tour Services and say, hey, I'm joining this other tour. They will have already added you because the lead person who booked it will have said, hey, we're adding, you know, in this case, Sharon to the tour. And then you'll put either a credit card or a gift card or something down for your piece of it. The third option, and it's the one that I personally recommend just because I use it all the time, is a travel agent, right? If you already have a travel agent that you love and work with, by all means, go with it. If you have somebody like Sharon, who's a travel agent, as a friend, reach out to them because they can book it for you. And in doing so, you just relieve a lot of the stress. Like they handle any questions with Disney. They know the rules and the regulations. They kind of coordinate it all. And then you just get to show up on a stress-free vacation. But then they can also do other things for you, like your hotel accommodations. And by the way, your airfare and stuff like that. It doesn't cost you anything. Like, nope. Travel agents are free. This is the big thing that nobody understands. I'm like, why wouldn't you use a free expert?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I used to do all my planning, and then I'd call my travel agent and go, okay, I want these restaurants. So on these dates, this is what I want. I'd give her everything and then let her do it. But this is what I want. You don't have to do any extra stuff. Just do this. That's all I need.
Yeah. Yeah. And you can do that, right? So you can have them, you can tell them what restaurants you want to go to. So to the question on the screen about VIP tours, can they take you to restaurants? They certainly can. Some people actually do VIP tours and do a full sit down meal. More often than not, most people will do a quick serve. The great part about this is if you know where you're going, some of the quick serve locations, they can actually take the order and order ahead for you so that when you get there, it's already to pick up. Other cool fact about VIP tours, and then I know we want to get to Ken, but here's a fun fact for all the Starbucks lovers out there. And no, that's not a Taylor Swift reference, but it might be. This is why we can't have nice things.
Starbucks is life.
But the Starbucks on Main Street, right? But the Starbucks on Main Street at Magic Kingdom.
I was famous there once.
You were famous,
I was famous there once. It was this thing where one particular cast member who was part of the college program she and I just really clicked one night while I was standing on Main Street and doing a food review on a trash can. And she was standing outside to try to get people to come in, and we started talking, and we hit it off. She's a really good kid. Next thing I know, I come in the next Monday night, and the person at the door was like, oh, you're Corey. He's like, you're Corey. Yeah. Okay. All right. Yeah. Oh, and he's like, oh, she's working tonight. I'm like, oh, okay. And I went in, and like 14 people behind the desk, the counter was like, hey, it's him. So through their entire run, I was a little bit famous there.
So Lawrence, the takeaway of this is when I come down to Florida tomorrow, either let's say Friday, Corey's going to show up at the parks and I'm going to be there and be like, oh my God, it's Corey. Like, I'm going to like recruit people to fan this up and make it big, and we're going to record it and we'll send it to you.
Yeah.
Oh, fun.
I was in the parks last month, and I was in Disney Springs. I hadn't gotten to the parks yet. My first night I'm in Disney Springs, we're just walking around World of Disney. Hey, Lawrence, and I'm looking around thinking it was my family who was with me, and it wasn't, and it was one of the viewers, and he came over. So I told Corey, I actually texted him. I was like, you wouldn't guess what happened to me. He's like, you got recognized, didn't you? It was the first time I had been recognized, and I'm looking around because none of my family was with me.
So we were like, it's very, you never forget the first time, let me tell you.
I know. So on the Starbucks thing real briefly, it's cool because if you are a Starbucks fan, let's say you're at Epcot or Hollywood Studios and you know you're going to the Magic Kingdom. Right? Thank you, Disney. I appreciate this. Like, I would be totally shouting. And I'm going to shout, just so you know, I will shout for both of us when I go, because I'm going to talk to Corey after this podcast. And I'm going to be like, look, we have to meet up. But let's say you're at Epcot or Hollywood Studios, and you're like, hey, we want to jump over to Magic Kingdom. Great. They're going to put you in a van out back. They're going to drive you over there. But what happens if you get there and you're like, hey, gosh, I really would love to go to Starbucks? In this case, when you go to Magic Kingdom, it's the one Starbucks there, and they don't have mobile ordering. Unless you're on a VIP tour. This is relatively new. You essentially will just, didn't she just write bestie on your cup?
Oh, yeah, she did. Yeah, she used to write bestie whenever I'd get my Starbucks cup.
So now I got to write bestie on his cup. Okay, got it. I'm taking
That's
notes.
My family right there. That is living in Diz right there, by the way.
That's right.
Yeah.
That my is.
Son and daughter
I like
there.
It.
Grew up
Aww. In But yeah, they'll take the orders on their device, they'll send it in ahead of time, and then when you get to the Magic Kingdom, they'll run inside. Now, you do have to pay for it, obviously. You'll give them their credit card or whatever, but they'll run inside, they come out through the back, and all of your drinks are there ready to go for your entire group. So that's a really cool perk as well. Also, if you're in the parks, and let's say you're over at Magic Kingdom and you're getting ready to go on Haunted Mansion, and maybe you want chicken tenders. You could actually give your credit card to the VIP guide. They'll run over, grab chicken tenders for you while you're on the ride. So you come off Haunted Mansion and chicken tenders are right there for you to nosh on, right? So that's obviously the great part. I plan on asking Corey for his autograph as well. I 100% agree. Sharon, you're amazing. I am so grateful that you have allowed me to help with this lovely group of VIPs. So thank you.
I did. I put the link for the Facebook group in the description of the show. So if anybody's interested, they can find the link right there. I also put the link to fundinglove.com in the description of the show. So if you want to donate or see how you can help, the links will be in the description of the show below.
Now, Sharon, if you want to stick around for Tiki Room, I'm all for it. But I figure we'll bring in Ken Bruce and let him talk, because I think it's fascinating. Like, I talked to him as he was, as I was prepping for some of the work, and I just happened to be talking to him, and I was like, yeah, like the animatronic bird and like the story. And he was like, that is not actually how it all started. He's like, so I know that you haven't read the book. Is he around?
Is Sharon going to, is she sticking around? You can, you're welcome to. I just wanted to make sure if you were leaving that, how can people find you if they want to book a trip?
You can, reach me. There's when you get into the Facebook group, Jason puts all those little posts, and he has a form where you can contact me if you want to know about like a VIP tour. But I also have a website, and you can email me through that. And the website is mywdwplanner.com, like my Walt Disney World planner. I'm super grateful to be here, and I'm super excited about what we have up our sleeves next, right, Jason? For our little surprise for our members. It's going to be great. And, I hope we can do some good, like you guys are doing with the Funding Love. So
yeah, it's awesome.
I love it.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Sharon. I also put your website in the chat so everybody can reach out to you if they have questions about the tours or about travel.
Awesome. Thank you.
So I think we should all have Corey sing the Tiki song as we bring Ken in.
let's see. I've been known for singing wrong lyrics, right, Lawrence?
That's for sure.
Well, if anybody is going to be able to call him out on it, it would be probably Cat.
Right.
In the tiki, so tiki, let's
tiki, tiki, tiki room.
Let's bring Ken in.
It's an earworm, though. You'll never get it out of your head.
I know. But you know what? I'll say
this is what
that
happens.
Song. We go to the show and you watch it, and I don't think you're really listening to all the words. You're just enamored by everything happening around you. But I didn't really get to appreciate the lyrics and how funny those birds are until I was outside doing yard work, just listening to Disney music. And I'm like, wait a minute. This is really well written and really funny. Yeah. So,
yeah. Right.
See, but I'm older now, so I can't remember lyrics.
It's on my Disney playlist as well.
Yes.
There you go.
For sure.
All right. Well, without further ado, I will bring in Ken.
I'm here.
Da, 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 da.
Welcome, Ken. Thank you for your patience. Thanks for being here.
Can you hear me? That's the big question.
Yes. Yes.
We can
hear you. Welcome.
You know, I'm new to all this, so I'm ready to go.
Well, Ken, thank you for being here.
Thank you for inviting me. A pleasure. Like, you're a formidable group. I have to be a little careful here. I have to be wary because, you know, have you guys on my side is great. You know,
number
what,
nine.
What did you say?
We dropped one place. We are number 9 in the best Disney podcast out of 129. Disney podcast at feedspot.com.
That's scary.
We peaked at seven.
We did.
So after this episode airs with Ken, we're going up to number 2.
That's right.
And then we give it a little time, and as it expands, we go to number 1.
I love it.
Sure. Ken, plan. Just so you know, it is safely here. I have it. And I am bringing it with me tomorrow on the plane down to Walt Disney World. So I'm beginning the journey, and I just wanted to. I cannot wait.
I hope you like it. I think you'll like it. And thank you, Sharon, for sticking around. So I promise to say at least something that you'll be like, oh, cool.
I mean, we all love the ride, so it's great. Thank
well,
you.
First of all, it is not a ride.
Experience. Sorry.
Attraction.
There you go. It's
attraction. Do you call it an experience or an attraction?
Oh, well, Disney would want you to call it an attraction. They, you know, they actually had, you know, writers back in the day, way back when, to make sure that they didn't call things rides, they called them attractions. And they had a whole list of things that's like, just to keep it away from the words that people would use to describe carnivals or fairs. Walt was like, this is going to be a much classier experience.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't call them rides, we call them attractions.
Attractions, yeah.
Exactly. So can I just jump in, Jason?
Yes.
I don't know who's running the show. Is it Corey's show?
Tonight it might just be Jason's show.
Yeah, I think we're guests of Jason tonight. He's been an amazing guest.
It's gone completely off the rails. So yeah,
it's probably Corey's and Lawrence's, but it's like Jason. Wow.
Yeah. So graphic wise, I've been running the graphics tonight.
Yeah.
There you go. Okay. So this book. I'm in the animation world, but I'm, of course, a big Disney fan, and this book came about because of many reasons. But one of them, Jason tweaked, because there's a lot of mythology that is not only around that not only surrounds the Enchanted Tiki Room, but virtually everything at the park. And you have to understand that when you take a VIP tour at Disney, they are about selling the magic. They are about selling stories that. But, you know, that the fans respond to with a tear in the eye and you know, that warms the heart. That is all valid and real. But there's a simplifying of the story that does disservice to the what I will argue till my last breath is that does disservice to the much more interesting story that is much more complex and much more involved. and isn't an easy sell. So Jason brought up to me, I guess, earlier, like that idea that that has been shared by everybody about, you know, this antique that Walt Disney found in an antique store in New Orleans in, I think it was the 40s. And that little antique bird that he purchased jump-started the Tiki Room, which is an oversimplification to the 11th degree. And it's the first myth that I break down. Yes, that little antique bird does play a part in the story, but not in a clean, simple, sweet, heartwarming way. It does have a link to, you know, the birth of Audio-Animatronics, but he didn't buy that bird and then eventually think, wow, wouldn't a restaurant full of animated birds be really, really cool? And that is one of many myths that are, they're frustrating because they are an oversimplification, and there are plenty of them. Another one I can share is one that's been bandied about forever, is after the Tiki Room opened at Disneyland, a bird was put out front called the Barker Bird that would basically tell people about the show, because after the show opened, one person filled out a guest comment card and said, I love your show, but you should have a bird out front that tells people what the heck this is, because it was so new. It was so revolutionary. And the myth goes something like this. After, you know, that bird caused a traffic jam at the front of Adventureland, which was a problem. And so they had to remove the bird. That is the myth. And that is not true.
Not true.
Because, well, okay, sure, the bird caused a traffic jam, but there wasn't a problem in that. The problem was the bird was a maintenance nightmare. Mm-hmm. If the bird had in fact been a big problem and was causing a traffic jam, the bird would have been removed, what, in a month, in 2 months, maybe 6 months? Not 6 years. It was there for 6 years. Throughout those 6 years, not only was it annoying for the cast members to hear because it was just a nonstop annoyance for anybody that worked there, it's charming to the people that went to the park. It was difficult to keep running. It was out in the sun. And you have to remember, too, in the 60s and 70s, 1960s and 1970s, Orange County was very, very smoggy. The bird was exposed to the wind and the rain and the smog and the heat and the moisture at night. And it was hoisted high above the front entrance where initially you were to buy a ticket. And it was just getting beaten raw by the elements. So they had to constantly replace it, and they had to constantly figure out how to make it stronger and try to make it more weatherproof. But eventually, after 6 years, they're like, enough is enough. People seem to know about the Tiki Room, and there's no need in telling people about it. There is a Barker bird still in Florida, as far as I know. He's better protected. He's a toucan, same voice. And I think he's still there. Pretty mm-hmm. sure he's still there.
Corey and I will have to go Friday and verify.
Verify that the toucan is still there, who would be giving the same spiel as back in 1963. Now, because I know Jason went on, I'm going to just keep going on. I'm not going to sit here and listen for you to ask questions. I think I was going to say what's important, too, is to put the attraction in context. So this opened in Disneyland. It's before the Pirates of the Caribbean. It's before the Haunted Mansion. It's before Small World or Lincoln. The e-tickets, though they weren't called e-tickets at the time, would have been, the submarine was open. Matterhorn was open. Jungle Cruise. That was it. I mean, the Golden Horseshoe Review was not a live show, but that was the one of the must-sees back then. So the park was a very, very different animal. And you have to understand that when the Enchanted Tiki Room opened, no one had seen anything remotely like it. It was one of a kind. The idea that it was a push button automated review, the idea of a bunch of inanimate birds coming to life to put on a show, not let alone a bunch of orchids and a few totems around the room. It was mind-blowing. Absolutely jaw-dropping. Early people would, you know, there was one reviewer that equated it with the profound feelings he felt going into the first these amazing European cathedrals. So it may not be the best attraction at the park, certainly at Disneyland or in any of the parks, but it is the most consequential theme park attraction of all time. So I was like, I'm going to write that book. I'm going to remind people of that, because it changed not only Disneyland, it changed the tone of Disneyland forever at the time, but it changed an entire industry overnight and has influenced every theme park that has come after it. The people that were working on it were doing something utterly new, and they were borrowing from technology from our defense department, equipment that was antiquated at the time, but that the Disney engineers were like, this will work for us. So again, completely new, completely weird. Other reasons the show is so important. It's one of the few, it's one of Disneyland's most personal projects of all time. He loved it, and the inspiration for it can go all the way back to a Walt that was a kid. What else? The first Disneyland attraction with Walt's name on it. And again, Walt's name was on everything. Every Disney studio production had Walt Disney Presents. But I promise you, when it said Walt Disney Presents, the chance of Walt actually having any sort of impact on it was minuscule, if anything. Mary Poppins was certainly a movie he was close to. But once it came to Disneyland, he was hands on. So his putting his name on it meant something. It was incredibly personal to him. It was brought him a huge amount of joy. His fingers are on it. And I will argue that if you really want to get to know Walt Disney, it's all in the show. It's all in the show. So yeah, it was the first Disney attraction to have its own theme song written for it. First Disney ticketed attraction, because the Golden Horseshoe had a song written specifically for it, but that was a live show. But this was the first Disneyland attraction that had its own theme song written specifically for it. And I could go on and on. I wrote a book that took me 6 years to write and 10 years to research. It took a huge chunk of my life. But it's at the service of reminding people how important this attraction is in the history of the company, in the history of Walt himself, and in the history of theme parks as well. So there's so many different things that come together, but that's me going on. Anyway.
And was that the catalyst for you writing the book about this attraction, was because it was a very personal attraction to Walt Disney?
The catalyst for writing it is you know, I've been a student of Disneyland since I was a kid. I wasn't going, you know, it went from I'm going there because of the magic to I'm going there to study everything about it. I went to art school. Brad Bird, who wrote the intro to it, the director of Incredibles and Ratatouille and Iron Giant, writer and director, shared a similar thought, because he also went to CalArts. And you get to a point where you go from loving it for the spell it puts over you to I have to study how this is done. So for years, I was trying to figure out how everything was done at Disneyland, and definitely a student of the park. So once an opportunity opened to write a book about it, I was like, I can't imagine this is the book I've always wanted to read, and no one has written it. So therefore, I guess the job comes to me. And I can't believe I put up with the process. It's a difficult thing to do, to write a book, but I'm glad I saw it through. And part of the fuel to writing the book was I would see people leave the show halfway in, and I wanted to shake them. I wanted to run after them and say, if I could tell you why this is important, maybe you not only will go back in, but you'll see it from a new light and learn to appreciate it. Because yes, it's a little clunky around the edges. They've cleaned it up a bit, not too long ago. That being said, it is of another time. But seen in the right context, I think new audiences will discover a new layer of, for lack of a better word, enchantment about that show. It is important. It needs to be. It is due respect.
I love so, the stand Ken, I guess you take. I was going to say, I love the stand that you take on something you believe in that, and you're willing to take.
You know, it's funny because I wrote about, I've written extensively about the park in various articles here and there. And so you get to hear things like Disneyland is not a museum, because, you know, Disneyland has to, and Walt's quote, which I'm almost sure someone else wrote for him, which is, you know, Disneyland will always keep growing and changing. And it was meant to be that. It was meant to be something that was improved upon. But a lot of us would argue that, sure, Disneyland needs to remain relevant to new generations, and Disneyland is not a museum. And yet, Walt Disney's Enchanted Tiki Room has earned a place in one easily. And so part of the argument for writing the book too is, please don't turn the Tiki Room into a stroller parking lot, please. Mm. Like, yes. It is profoundly important to the history of the park and incredibly personal to Walt. And it changed everything. You know, it laid the groundwork for everything that followed. And it changed Disneyland from a charming but messy park into a park that had a clear tone. If you could go back to the early days, the first, say, 8 years of Disneyland, I promise you, all you lovely fans of the parks would not recognize it. And you wouldn't probably appreciate it. It was a lot of dirt. There's a lot of weeds. It was a lot of stacks of wood still sitting there. It was not a park that had found its way yet. Walt knowing firmly that, you know, there was work to be done. And another bit of the myth making too is that lovely story of, you know, you don't think about it, but that park was, when it opened, was not ready. It just wasn't ready. It needed years. It needed years. It was rushed. They put together Disneyland with a limited budget and in 1 year. It was a mess. You would not recognize it. So things like the Tiki Room and later alterations to the Jungle Cruise were finally like laying down roots for the very tone of the park. So that's one of the reasons also the Enchanted Tiki Room is so important, because once it showed up, and actually a couple sets in the Jungle Cruise as well, once it showed up, it was like, aha, this is what the park's direction needs to be moving forward. I mean, previously, most of the shows were off the shelf. Of course, they had a link to Disney because, of course, it's like Mr. Toad's Wild Ride and you know, Snow White.
It was one of my favorites.
Yeah, but they were off the shelf rides. A few things about them that were new and revolutionary, like the black light, use of black light. But again, the Tiki Room changed everything, and it also is one of the few remaining things left at Disneyland that has Walt's fingerprints all over it. Mm. He was there. Like, you sit, when you sit in the Tiki Room today, it's likely that Walt sat there. When you walk from corner to corner, Walt was there. He was bringing in VIPs after hours and before hours, and showing it off like a giddy, you know, schoolboy. So he loved it. He absolutely loved it.
Ken, I have maybe a two-pronged question for you here, but
I'm ready.
One is, when you were doing the research, as yes. you went through it, you know, you had just talked, as you're talking about the Tiki Room, you talk about these aha moments. Mm-hmm. Was there an aha moment when you were looking at a piece of research or something in your journey that you went, wow, like, I didn't know this, I didn't realize this, or just something that sort of stuck out at you? Like, if you were to encapsulate that, what was that aha moment? And then, I guess, and second to that, and kind of going hand in hand, what is the wonder, what is the one thing that as people walk away from your book that you want them to understand, maybe even bigger than the book, bigger than anything else, including Walt, but like, you've poured your heart into this. What's the one thing you want them to walk away with?
Starting with the second question first, I didn't set out to write it this way, but apparently I did, because a handful of people have said the same thing, that all humility aside, this might be, and again, they're saying it, and I'm like wowed by the fact that they would have even said it, is that this is the best book ever written about Walt's creative process. We have lots of books on Walt, but we don't have a real, like, day-to-day kind of crunchy feeling of how he worked and put things together. And so to hear that feels wonderful. Someone surmised that it was because I come from the creative field of animation. So I'm not a college professor, say, or, you know, writing the book. I'm someone who's been in the animation industry for years, decades. And so I'm writing it, whether I know it or not, from a certain perspective, from the perspective of someone who makes things. So if you come away with that, that is delightful too. And by that, I mean, come away with the idea that creating something is chaos, and it's messy, and it doesn't start from, I have a dream and boom, I have it. Walt was making this up as he went. Though many of you perhaps would like to think otherwise, Walt was not a deity. He was, he made wrong turns and went down wrong alleys and had one idea that would then grow to another. The Tiki Room is a perfect example of so many different messy, chaotic pieces coming together and then building on itself. There were a lot of missteps as the thing became something totally different. If people come away with that, and of course come away with the fact that this is the Enchanted Tiki Room, specifically at Disneyland, because it is in many ways different from the one in Florida. If they come away with the fact that this is a pop culture masterwork, that it should be treated like a piece of art, because it really is, that makes me happy, because I use the word sacred, but not lightly, and certainly not in a religious way. But it is. It's bigger than the sum of its parts. Nothing like it before. And again, very personal to Walt. Aha moments, there are a handful of them, but one of them, to read about in the book, I kept hearing about Walt loved that his engineers, and I call them engineers, I know you guys call them Imagineers, but back then they were engineers, would tell Walt, they were using defense tech that had been deauthorized, decommissioned, to run this state-of-the-art show. And Walt loved that, and he would always like tell people in the press, you know, that they were using the same technology that would launch missiles, and helped the Polaris missile system helped run the Tiki Room. He loved that because he definitely was an optimistic futurist. Loved that, but I always was like, what is the connection? Like, what exactly is the connection? What exactly did the government let the Disney Imagineers use? And how was it linked to the Polaris submarine and the missile system? So I went into a whole the old rabbit hole on that one. And I could never figure out exactly what it was. What was the technology that they were taking from it? But the aha moment was it was a testing. It was to test the missiles. So they had a giant gantry, not dissimilar to the one that rocks the Star Tours cabins, that would measure the pitch and roll of the ocean. They could actually record with audio tape the pitch and roll of the ocean and then play it back, play the platform doing the same thing as the ocean, so that they could put these missiles that needed to know exactly where to go at any given time, where to go. So they would test the missiles out on that platform as it moved in space, and then launch while it was rocking back and forth, or test the equipment on it. So that was a system that could record motion and play it back. And that's exactly what the Disneys needed. By the time the Disneys found out about it, the Defense Department, which has all the money in the world, was onto a different system, but they were happy to like, here, you want this, you want these cabinets and you want this technology, have at it. And they sold it to the Disneys for not too much, a lot, but not that much. And Disney was delighted. It was like, you know, Walt would say, if I wasn't able to get this Defense Department equipment, this show would never have happened. It was just too expensive. So that's what helped him out. So again, to find that specific link, because no one really talks about it. Not very glamorous, kind of messy, but it really was linked to that testing system for the Polaris missile system.
Wow.
Yeah. Whoever would have thought that?
I think you guys have now figured out. I mean, aside from, you know, all of these different pieces that we've talked about now, and I know we've kind of gone through a couple of different spaces of the gala. We've talked about VIP tours and then with Ken, but they all are connected. And the backstory of all of them is threaded in this idea that, you know, I've just been lucky to be able to meet all of them. Right. I mean, if you think about it.
Well, I'm lucky to meet you, Jason.
No, absolutely not. Because standing in line at Guardians got me to Funding Love, which got me to Sharon and her group. Yeah. And that work has honored the legacy of Walt in a lot of ways, in terms of keeping the magic alive. People then like can have graciously responded to my message, reaching out just the same way, Lawrence, that you did to me. You know, I think to me, this and what we've talked about, but the connections that we've all shared now in our own way, maybe Ken feels differently, I don't know, but like to me, that's the Disney that I love. That's the world that I appreciate. And hopefully today, over the last hour and a half or so, you've seen that kind of come together, because if it wasn't for any one of these points in time, all of us that were here, we wouldn't have met each other. We wouldn't be here. We certainly wouldn't be talking about, you know, go order Ken's book, because it just came out. But it's on Amazon, right?
Yeah. The only place to get it now, perhaps it will change, is amazon.com. Just search for Before the Birds Sang Words and you'll find it. Yeah.
And that the link for the book is in the description of the show. So if you need to find
it. Oh, great. Thank you, Lars.
And that'll take you right to the book. I ordered my copy.
Yay.
And it was next day delivered. So it was, I got it right away.
Little Amazon Prime action. I like it.
Love Amazon Prime. So if any of you, as I said, want the book, you can go to the link in the description of the show and order yours. But we are going to give away a copy of the book tonight. If you type in Tiki, 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 as you see it on the screen, into the chat, we will pick one lucky winner in just a few minutes.
So put that in right now. Even if you put it in previously, just put it in one more time.
And, I'm putting it in right now.
Yeah. Yes, yes, yes. I hope you win. Good luck. We'll break the rules tonight.
I just have to ask, would that be like autographed from Ken to Ken?
He's used to autographing a lot of things for himself.
Yeah.
But yes, just put Tiki in again one more time.
Everybody. I will just say, as we are, I know, wrapping up, I just want to say thank you to Sharon, to Lawrence, Corey, Ken. You guys are all incredible. Your support, your time. Ken, you're just, I absolutely love the fact of your personality. And seeing you for the first time on camera is just special. So thank you for having us. Thank you for allowing me to hijack this podcast. And if somehow you go from 8 down to 14, it's not my fault.
But if we go up to 5, you'll be invited back next week.
That's right. That's right.
I mean, look, I love talking about, like, I've done the Burbank tour. I'm standing in Walt's apartment above Disneyland, above the firehouse. Incredible. My fingers are crossed. I'm going to Disneyland in a couple of weeks. I really want to ride on the Lily Bell. And
Jason,
then
you are so hardcore. This is terrifying.
It's scary. I'm also lucky. I am doing 21 Royal coming up too. So I know it's like,
name so dropper.
Jason, did you know what Lily's middle name is?
Bell?
It's Isabella. So Lily, we call her Lily Bell. And so when we were there, I was like, you have to take a picture. And she's like this in the photo. I was like, come on. But now
having met her, that's totally her.
She's got a lot of spunk. She was sitting in here listening because she wanted to be here and like hear everything. But then she was like, can I go now?
Yeah, the moment I showed up, can I go now?
I mean, she's 11, you know, you can't.
Oh, okay.
we'll give people just a few more minutes, moments to put in Tiki, Tiki, Tiki into the chat. And while we're doing that, three Tikis. And we will run our ad for our sponsor and then come right back.
Two, you're disqualified. Four Tikis, you're disqualified. It's three Tikis.
Three Tikis.
That's right.
Do you have to capitalize?
We're looking for a home that offers the perfect blend of luxury, comfort, and convenience with Disney World in your backyard. Victor Naraki is a licensed realtor with Vision Home Real Estate, LLC. He is here to help you find the home of your dreams. With over 13 years of experience in the vacation home market and a proven track record of success, Victor is the perfect partner to guide you through every step of the home buying process. So why wait? Visit DisneyAtYourDoorstep.com today to learn more about Victor's exclusive range of properties and schedule a viewing with him today. Your dream home is just a click away.
And Victor wants to remind you also, I have to recut that commercial because he made some changes. And you can go to CelebratingFlorida.com. And the email is victor@celebratingflorida.com.
So now you're trying to tease me to move to Florida. I understand how this is.
Let me tell you, Jason, I get that every day. When are you moving? So you need to move. So you're going to move, right? I'm like,
where are you?
I'm in North Carolina.
Oh, I'm 15 minutes from New York City. So.
Okay.
I'm in North Carolina too. So,
Corey, where are you?
I am about a 50-minute drive from Walt Disney World.
So you're all closer to that. Okay.
Yeah, in case you didn't know, I live stream from the parks 2 to 3 times a week.
Cool.
So I am there quite a bit. I'm known as the goat of Disney because no one eats on stream more than I do.
So we're all going to show up
for you when I'm there next.
And, Yeah, you have to scream really loud, ask for his autograph. It's a thing.
Yeah.
And Ken, when you go to the park, if I see you at Disneyland, I'm going to do that to you, just so you know. I'm
going
to
be like,
oh my God, that's Ken! Yeah,
absolutely.
We're going to fan this out. It's going to be...
Oh, Jason, my free publicist. I love you.
He's like the world's best publicist.
Oh my God. I was just before he showed up. Well, okay.
Jason's going to be our booking agent for the.
Well, he's good. Like, Jason, look into that work because you're really good. No, so Jason reached out to him and was like, can you give me some free books? And this was on the cusp of like everybody and their mother me giving free books to them early on. And I'm like, oh, someone wants free books? Oh, yeah, we're doing this, you know, this auction-y thing. And I'm like, and all I could think of is like, they want 100 books and I can't do it. I need to pay for food.
Yeah.
And so I'm like, okay, well, how many do you need? And he's like, oh, I just need 2. And I'm like, oh, well, 2 I can do. But the millisecond I said, sure, 2, he came back, dear Jason, with the equivalent of like $100,000 in like free publicity. Like, holy cow, he went to the moon. Like, you need to meet this person, and you need to meet this person, and can you meet this? And it was coming like a million miles an hour. And I'm like, that was the best 2 books I'll ever get in my life.
There you go.
And it was a good lesson because I was in a, you know, I was probably hangry when you were like, give me free books.
Right.
I was like probably in not the world's best mood, but that was a lesson. Like, Ken, just take a breath and hear them out and don't always feel like you need to shut the door. Boy, did that work out in my, I mean, not that it was like it needed to, because it's such a great, like, don't get like such a beautiful, you know, a group you have going to do that. So I would have probably helped out in one way or another. But
you are too kind.
Like, holy cow.
I love helping. I mean, Lauren's messaged me and I'm like, yeah, I can book your entire show. We can go for like 3 hours. How long do you want to go? We have.
Yeah.
Does this mean he's going to book?
This is your next job. You could, Jason, you could be an amazing, like, you know, press secretary.
Yeah.
Okay.
So is he going to book for us going forward?
I'm telling you,
100%.
He's already said, you know, show 50. He's got ideas. So I'm keeping him in my back pocket there.
That sounds good.
Yeah, but Jason,
Ken,
this
will be fun.
On,
you're actually going to get to see who.
That's right.
Get to see who wins your book tonight.
Yeah,
that's true. That's
so
true.
So no, Jason, from this point on, don't do it for free.
You notice how he did that? He's like, now that I'm through the door,
exactly,
everybody else pays.
Exactly.
All right, so
I'm draw excited. Here, draw
and we
winner.
Will see who wins?
23. Okay.
Here we go.
Here we go. Woohoo!
Oh!
You have to ship it to Wales.
Now you have to ship it to Wales.
Now I
exactly
to Wales.
Congratulations.
Congratulations, Andy.
And enjoy that postage fee.
So
it's probably cheaper to drop ship it from Amazon.
Yeah, we're gonna look into that.
Yeah, okay, I need to learn about that, because this happens sometimes.
Well, wait a minute, my book is not being sold in the UK yet.
Uh-oh. I'll send it extra exclusive.
For Andy, we're going to work on that. I'll get it to you, Andy. Don't worry about it. So email us.
Yeah. Media mail. Just remember, media mail.
Yeah.
Like I said, I'm out in the parks, and I'm out there late on East Coast time, and Andy's in the UK, and so he stays up till 3-4 in the morning while I'm running around Magic Kingdom at 11 p.m. Eastern time, you know, so he is so dedicated, and he doesn't miss a stream, and there's a lot of people that are deserving of winning, but Andy is definitely one of those, for sure.
Andy sends me voice messages on Instagram every day.
Same.
Every day. It's incredible.
Love it.
Congratulations, Andy.
Yes.
well deserving. So we will, you get us your information and we will get you a book one way or the other.
Ken, will you look to have the book narrated at some point? And
yes, I am already beginning to look into that. I am. So give it a month or two or three, and I've already got that ball rolling. And my hope is that when you guys find out who actually is narrating it, you will
have them on the show.
Yeah, let us know.
Tease?
because if it happens, it's the best.
It's a big one.
I just want to put in a note that after this podcast, Ken, I'll be reaching out to you to figure this out and who it is. Just because, I mean, like, I'm your publicist and all now.
Jason, it hasn't happened, so I don't want to say yeah. until I know. But the ball is rolling. Definitely,
we'll put out some good vibes for you for sure. Nice. You said you're in animation. What do you do exactly?
Okay, I've worn every hat. So let me see. I was a storyboard artist on Shrek, and before that, Fern Gully, and a Pixar Toy Story 3, and Up, the balloon movie. In TV, I worked on the first season of The Simpsons. I worked at Nickelodeon on Fairly Odd Parents, Invader Zim, Ren and Stimpy, Warner Brothers for a film I don't want to mention because it was awful, Disney Studios on a project that didn't go through, TV Disney for Phineas and Ferb. I could keep going. I won two.
So you're a legend, basically.
Not really. No. I am not. I just am lucky. I just, you know, eventually you just. Well, I'm working on Family Guy now, but if you guys know.
Oh, PETA. My name is Brian the Dog.
Exactly. Not a show for everybody, but I must say.
I love Family Guy.
The humor is right down my alley, unfortunately.
Same.
It's frat boy humor. It makes me laugh.
Oh, yeah.
I worked on a miniseries called Over the Garden Wall that is carted out every Halloween now, which is a charming, like, six or seven parter. I don't even remember. That I won a Team Emmy for, which was great. And then an episode of Adventure Time I worked on that also won me another Emmy. So lots and lots and lots and lots of projects over much time. Brad Bird, who did my introduction, he was my first boss on a half-hour TV cartoon called Family Dog, which was part of Amazing Stories way back when. Amazing Stories was an anthology series, all live action except for one cartoon that Steven Spielberg produced. It was on NBC, yeah, I think. Yeah. And then Brad worked on The Simpsons when I was there as well. So yeah, lots of projects. Many different hats, Family Guy is the last for me. That's fine, I'm down. So yeah,
that's awesome. You know, I kind of asked that too because it's been many years now, and I wear many hats too. Outside of Disney too, I'm in the medical field three times over. I had physical therapy for 30 years, over 20 wow. years of massage therapist and personal trainer.
I'll take 130. Thank you very much.
All right. Sounds good. I'm the Walmart of, you know, somebody comes to see me for massage, you know, or say personal training, they got a little something going on. I can work on that. I can give them therapy. I can give them massage therapy, PT at the same time. So it's pretty cool. But then I dip my hat into the YouTube waters and we've been doing that for 6 years. Yep. But for many years, I've had people comment on the level of my voice, and you need to get into voice acting. You need to do something like that. So finally, what's pushed me to pursue it a little bit more now is I went into a patient's house a couple months back, and his wife is an award-winning filmmaker, documentaries for like 40 years. And she was just another person that said that. But given her background, you know, she just looked at me and said, "You have like the sound of a 1990s DJ, but if you can find, you know, your range above and below that, she says, you can make a ton of money in this business. So I'm just starting to look into
interesting
how to even pursue something like that. So maybe you have some good tips on that, since you're kind of in that realm.
I do and don't, you know, yeah, I mean, the world of animation voiceovers, these, you know, these are pros, but you know, ultimately, if you've got a good voice, you know, they've got websites for that where you can actually, you know, shop for voice talent. And there's so many different voices that are required in this world, you know.
Yeah.
You know, do you need authoritative and stern? Do you need storytelling? Do you need children's, you know, a children's storybook vibe? There's so many different voices to cull from, but I would say don't waste any time. Start making a reel of different vocal attributes that you think you're strong at, and then you can get those out there in various ways, and maybe start the ball rolling. Yeah,
sounds good. That's kind of what I've come across in research. So yeah, I just have to find the time and get something together and let it happen.
Hey, I just spent 16 years on a book, so you can find the time.
So what's the next one? Is there another book in the works, Ken?
Jason, the answer is, oh God, no. I can't imagine. It's, you know, never say never, but at the moment, I just need a break because it's hard work, and it's like having a dog or a family. It's something you have that takes away from other things.
Sure. Your hard work maybe has paid off, and I just want, can you tell everybody, because I think this is really cool, there were a couple of posts where the book has a couple of new stamps on it. It's now in certain places. will you tell everyone, because I think it's a little self, I think the world needs to know that, because it's a great story.
Okay, well, it behooves you to know that I could have reached out to Disney to help me with the book. Can I use your archives? Can I use your libraries? Can I use your X, Y, and Z? I need photo rights. Had they allowed me, which I was highly doubtful, they certainly... I reached out to them to get some photo rights and got a firm bye-bye. had I reached out to them, I assure you they would not have allowed me to write the book that was in me. They are fiercely protective of the mythology. They are fiercely protective of their name, and they don't want you to know certain things. One of them being that Walt was a guy, not a god. Even people like Diane Disney Miller, who put together the Disney Family Museum, she had similar problems. She really did not like the fans that thought Walt was a god. That really, really annoyed her. So that being said, they wouldn't have allowed me to write the book. So see, I go off on a tangent. It's not a tangent. So the fact that after the book came out, the Disney studios made sure that they put the book in their library, and then a couple of Imagineers reached out and said, Ken, you just wrote the best book about my company, which is like thrilling. And that the Imagineering library bought a couple books and stamped them on the side, like you said, Jason, to make sure that they were included in the library. That felt really, really lovely. So even then the Disney studios put together a little gathering for me to have lunch in their executive dining room, and invite some amazing legends of Disney history to join me was beyond thrilling. So the fact that they've embraced me after the fact, I kept thinking, you know, halfway into the lunch, you know, where are the lawyers that are going to come out and handcuff me and take me away? But ultimately, yeah, the company appears to have embraced the effort, which I love, which is really, really great. And certainly the families, the people that I mentioned, many of them have reached out to me with nothing but praise. And I'm delighted. Yeah.
Yeah. The only reason I asked you to share that is because a past boss told me that in life, the best compliment that one could receive is to be told that they've made a difference. And if you think about it,
I don't know that I've made a difference, but I think you have.
Put it this way, I think you have. I think you don't give yourself enough credit for it. All jokes aside, I think the fact that it has that sort of space now in a very important way that was unexpected is more than making a difference.
You're very,
and I think you should take that away from this. So,
yeah, on that note, the idea that if someone with some sort of I don't want to say power, but influence at the company that might read the book that is reminded of the fact that both Disney World and all the parks have a history that should be respected. Of course, keep changing the parks, but do understand that there is a lot there's a subset of people that go to the parks just to get immersed in the history. And so when you take things down and take things away and manipulate things or change them, perhaps you need to think again before you do it. That's part of it too.
There's talk all the time about a fifth park here in Disney World, and it just got brought up again by the governor, apparently. Disney and the governor are getting along now, but this is an idea that I don't think, right? No one's ever said this that you've heard before, Lawrence, right? People always think, oh, what would you like for a fifth park? You know, people go to villains and things like that. But one of my ideas has always been, why don't we make it a museum park? If we happen to feel the need to get rid of tiki birds, goes to the fifth park. You can put the great movie ride at the fifth park. You can put 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea in that fifth park. I think that's a great idea, where if something does kind of have to go away, we can have a place for it.
Yeah, you know what? If the Tiki Room ever were to, I'm interrupting, I apologize. If the Tiki Room we really, really need a stroller parking lot, we have to get rid of this, no one seems to be going, whatever, then sure, take it away, but put it anywhere. So that, you know, even if you're doing one show a day, that because it is worthy of a museum, quite frankly, it is that important. But Corey, on that, because I just interrupted, we're getting to the point where VR is going to be a thing, and in your lifetime, you'll be able to just put a headset on and actually enjoy the Tiki Room in arguably even better audio and video fidelity. Like, you can just dial it up. I just want to watch the Tiki Room. Of course, it's different than actually being there, but that is one way of preserving history, is at least allowing fans to go back in time and say, I see America Sings or Bear Country Jamboree or something that is or Adventure, lots of things are gone. Adventure Through Inner Space, where you can actually feel like you're seeing it, but it just doesn't happen to be a brick and mortar attraction anymore.
Ken, we talked about a museum park and rides that are no longer here. What would you feel about Horizons?
I worked that attraction as a cast member, so way back when. That is one of the most amazing attractions ever cobbled together. Right up there, with things like Pirates of the Caribbean. It's gone. But what an amazing show that was. Would love to see it come back. Even, you know, Journey into Imagination, the original version, soup it up and redo it. Why is it gone? If you're gonna take something down and put something up, this is where it's so frustrating for me. You better be putting something there that's even better. So when they take horizons down and then put up, you know, a vomitron. That's sad. That's upsetting. When they take down a Journey into Imagination and make it a lesser show that is kind of edgy and cynical and not warm, that's a problem. And I could go on and on and on. That's a problem. Like, I love Horizons. Horizons was amazing.
So you probably didn't like the, I can't even remember the name of it, the newer version of the Tiki Room that they did.
Oh, which was there briefly, yeah.
Under new management.
Yeah, yeah. I write about it. No, it's that was a misstep and a giant one for many, many different reasons. The main one being it was put together by people who did not like the Enchanted Tiki Room. And it was also put together by people who didn't get the Disney parks, didn't understand why people go to Disneyland. They don't want cool and hip. You don't go to Disneyland. You never went to Disneyland or the parks for hip. And now you went for something utterly specific and unto itself. Disney is not cynical. Disney is, and again, has never been hip. And shouldn't be. It's something bigger and more difficult to do. It's called timeless. Timeless is a harder thing to pull off, but when you do, it's amazing.
Yeah, those are some good ones there, Pamela.
Yeah.
Bring back Kitchen Cabaret then too while we're at it. Love that.
Veggie, veggie, okay. fruit, veggie, veggie, fruit, fruit.
And that's another thing that's kind of upsetting is I remember, it's Epcot Center was such a specific idea. And over time, it went from specific idea to just land for the next attraction. It didn't matter little more than, it's just, we can now just put a new attraction in here. Does it have to fit in some, does it have to fit? No, it doesn't really have to. I guess that's all well and good, but you know, I miss the theme. I miss the theme in theme parks sometimes.
Yeah, for sure. I don't know if it's a little, it's more of like, we're hopeful that Epcot will get back to the roots, but as we see things coming out now, it leans towards the learning portion. You have Moana, which it's fun. It's labeled Moana, but it is teaching about the cycle of the water. And we think Communicore may bring some more of those things too.
Right.
So, I mean, Disney.
It's funny because it is difficult to do, but when it works, it's just amazing, which is sort of infotainment, the art of learning without realizing you're learning is an amazing thing when you pull it off. And Walt Disney was an expert at that. There's a little short cartoon called Donald in Math Magic Land, which you wouldn't realize, but by the end of it, one, you were entertained, and two, you had just learned some of the most complex mathematical principles ever to grace, you know, a textbook. And yet it's all there in what appears to be a lighthearted cartoon. That is insanely hard to pull off, and Epcot was doing its best to do that. But when it didn't gain traction, instead of executives going, well, we just need to work harder, they just said, we just need to give up. Go ahead and put in, you know, things here that are about IP. That to me is sad because a park that is more aligned to World's Fair the joy of learning something new and the joy of the miracle that is, you know, all things science and industry. That it's sad that idea went by the wayside. Ultimately, it's related to the fact that, you know, people weren't paying attention or people weren't buying it. They wanted warm and fuzzy. That's fine, you know, as it goes. But I personally find that kind of upsetting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
our the live stream part of our channel, we're in the parks multiple hours a week. I say that all the time. I'm like, you all are learning. You don't even know it, but you're learning how to do the parks. You're learning strategies, but you're having so much fun, you don't realize you're learning. I like to call ourselves a teaching channel. I recently started with this thing, right, Lawrence, where I'll go, okay, this is pro tip number 4,312, and then I'll give them a tip. And I just wonder how many people go, wow, they have that many tips. But, but we love to teach.
Yeah. How to do the parks. No. Yeah. If you can share an idea, you can get a kid or a young adult or even adult to, you know, have a wide-eyed reaction to something that they didn't even think about. That's magic. That's its own kind of magic.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
for sure. I'm in the parks tomorrow night, so I'll make sure I go to the Tiki Birds and in your honor in your book, and I'll plug that book one more time.
Yay.
Be there. Yay.
And it's the lyric is, where the birds sing words and the flowers croon, not bloom, croon.
Yes. Yep. Yep. I get a lot of
because everybody gets that wrong. I have no idea. anyway.
Well, flowers and bloom instead of crooning, you know, I guess.
Which, by the way, the Robert Sherman, who wrote that lyric, always hated because he did not like imperfect rhymes. So room and croon don't really, really rhyme, though they share the same sort of vowel sound. He hated that. Wished he could have changed it, but too late.
Interesting.
Too late.
There it is.
Anyway. Okay, I'm going to shut up now. Jason, you can keep talking.
Well, I appreciate all of you coming on. Jason, Jaren, Ken, and Jason, thank you for having us on your show tonight, because this has been phenomenal.
Yeah, it was a pleasure, Jason.
You're the best, Jason. You're changing the world.
I tell you that all the time, Jason. No.
You guys are all kind, but no, I appreciate it. This has been a ton of fun. Hopefully the first of many conversations amongst all of us where we can, share the things that we're passionate about.
Jason, sure. How many people did we have in the group before you came in?
I don't even remember.
I think it was like maybe 17,000, maybe. And then all of a sudden he joined and he was like, I want to do this. I want to do that. And I'm like, have at it, Jason. Have at it. And he's like, everything Jason touches is like gold. Did you tell them who you got to wish your wife a happy birthday?
I did not.
Tell them.
I might have sent a message to the publicist of one Dame Judy Dench and said, my wife is a huge fan of Spaceship Earth. She loves it. Her birthday's coming up. Like, gosh, I would love it if, you know, there's some way that I could, you know, do a, like a self-addressed stamped envelope or something to get something. I was going to have it framed and give it to my wife for her birthday. I said, you know, but if you want to go wild, you know, a video would be great. And then all of a sudden, her publicist sent me a video. And there is Dame Judy Dench sitting in her chair at home wishing my wife a happy birthday. And I, to this moment, and that was just like a month and a half ago. And I, to this moment, I remembered like squealing when I saw it come into my inbox. I was like, wait, what? Is this real? This has got to be spam. And then I saw the video and I was like, I can't believe this. And that was a wonderful surprise. My wife loves Disney as much as me, but she is the
kindest. No, Jason, nobody loves Disney as much as you.
No, she's she does love Disney a lot. But she is like my biggest supporter, my biggest cheerleader. She's just the kindest person. And so to be able to give that back to her, that pixie dust, pay it forward type thing, was quite fun. And that's why you all are here. I love just bringing Ken into the conversation and everything else. Thank you.
Thank you for that.
But Sharon, I mean, you guys are all just amazing people. And I just love people that have passions to be able to bring them all together and have a great time. I mean, good gosh, I think we might be having a record tonight for the longest. So.
Yeah.
I won't shut up.
Lando Calrissian himself wished us a happy holidays a couple years ago, which was pretty amazing.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Are you going to Star Wars then celebration in Tokyo?
Man, my son and I talked about that. No, but we did have the chance to go to Celebration here in Orlando just a few years ago. Very, very memorable time, just for a couple of quick things. Number one, seeing some of these humans in person is way too surreal for your brain to even wrap around. You know, to see Luke Skywalker and Peter Mayhew and all of them, it's mind-blowing. But we went across the street from the Orange County Civic Center, and we went to a little party that the hosts of the Star Wars show on YouTube at the time was doing, and they invited anybody over that wanted to go and do a little meet and greet and hang out. So we hung out with them for a bit, and my son disappeared for a little bit, and he was on the couch talking to people, and he came over later. And I said, "Who were you talking to?" He's like, "Oh, that's the guy that created BB-8 for Force Awakens and all that." And I was like, "Oh, wow, that's pretty cool." And I tried to get hired as the next Yoda talent, but they said we got that covered. I'm like, "Okay, but if you know Frank Oz goes, you know, I'd love the job." But we had a good time over there. But I have a pretty good Yoda.
Thank you.
That's my best voice. But
I love it.
Yeah. Yeah. So this was amazing. Even better than I expected. All three of you are amazing. I feel like we made new friends tonight.
Yeah.
And
you're all the best. Sure, it was pretty fun. Thank you for inviting me, Jason. Thanks. Well, and Corey Lawrence.
Absolutely.
Yes. Yes. Thank Jason first.
Yeah.
I know. It's like it's hard not to.
I know.
Jason.
I know.
He's like the
I put the links for Funding Love in the description. The link for the Facebook group is also in the description, and the link to get Ken Bruce's book Before the Birds Sang Words on Amazon is in the description of the show. So make sure to check that all out. I'm excited to do that. Definitely.
It's been amazing. Thank you all.
Thank you all.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much.
And again, yeah. Good luck with the book. And hopefully we'll talk again.
And good luck with Funding Love. I will peek into that as well.
Yeah. And we will, Jason, you need to make sure to reach out to Corey when you're going to be in the park so you guys can meet.
Tomorrow.
Yeah.
I'm going to roll the credits, but whoever wants to stay on for a moment can stay on, and we'll see you backstage.
I'm heading off to dinner. You guys are the best.
Thank you. Take care.
Aww.
All right, everyone in chat, thank you so much for staying with us all this time. You all are always amazing, and we thank you all for being so amazed, Diz. And it's been a lot of fun. So for the DizPod, I'm Corey.
And I'm Lawrence.
And we're just a couple of guys talking Disney.
See you next
time. On the backside of water.
The backside of water. That's right. So we'll see y'all next week. We'll be live again, 7 p.m. Eastern time on the DizPod. And if you're listening tonight live, we'll be live in the parks tomorrow. Magic Kingdom open till 11 p.m. Eastern time. We'll grab that Starbucks on the way out. And we'll have a good time riding rides, trying food, all the good stuff that we do. Until then, we'll see y'all later. People living over any potential.